Anyone who drives along the south coast of England cannot help to notice signs like these outside a number of towns, 30 to be precise. However, few travellers are likely to know just how important the Cinque ports were, or the extraordinary deal that existed between the Crown and these ports, which gave them tax exemptions and special privileges. It was a deal that was to be the basis of England's maritime power for nearly 500 years, and the beginnings of a relationship with my family that continues until today. This underground passage is part of a massive network of tunnels below Dover Castle, which guards the most important and the most influential of all the Cinque ports, Dover. This tunnel is right in the middle of what is known as Hellfire Corner, so called because Dover has so often been on the front line. Once earmarked as a nuclear fallout shelter, these tunnels only came off the top secret list a few years ago. The evacuation of Dunkirk in 1940 was organised from here, as was the famous Dover Patrol, which attempted to keep the English Channel open throughout the First and Second World Wars. These tunnels are the latest element in a history of defences stretching back over 900 years, and the struggle to control the Straits of Dover. Dover overlooks the narrowest point of the English Channel. France and the continent of Europe are a mere 22 miles away, and on a clear day with a pair of binoculars, you can even see the clock in Calais Town Square. Inevitably, this was England's most frequently attacked stretch of shoreline. The question of how to defend it has troubled the inhabitants of these shores from the very beginning. Even the Romans, in spite of building three forts here 2,000 years ago, couldn't stop people from attacking. It was Edward the Confessor who first thought of the solution, a regular supply of local ships and skilled men loyal to the crown. In 1050, King Edward formed a confederation of five, or in French, cinq, ports: Hastings, Romney, Hythe, Sandwich, and Dover. In later years, they were added to, and at their height in the 14th century, there were at least 18 ports stretching from Seaford in the west right up to Brightlingsea in Essex. The Cinque port's duty was to supply ships and crews, to defend the country from sudden attack, and to provide transport for the king and his army. Not only were they vital to the kingdom's defences, but the Cinque ports are where England's maritime power began. In those days, ships were of a simple design and built on the beaches. The crews were mostly fishermen who knew the Straits of Dover and the English Channel better than anyone. Their skill as seamen was unrivalled. They developed a unique style of combat, which involved throwing clouds of acidic quicklime in their enemies' faces and then ramming them. For the idea to work, it was essential the Cinque ports were loyal to the crown. Edward the Confessor proposed a deal which allowed them extraordinary privileges.
Effectively, it was self-government for the Cinque ports in return for providing, for the Cinque ports providing a almost basic navy, and also rights of passage across the channel. The quid pro quo from the portsman's point of view was self-government, the ability to levy taxes, the ability to run their own courts and to punish criminals, and bearing in mind we're on a coastal area, the important benefit of salvage which came ashore, salvage on the sea and from wrecks.
And was this very unusual at the time?
I think it was probably quite exceptional, probably the only case where it occurred. And it was based totally on mutual dependency on each other, the Crown needing the ability to move and to defend the coast and move across to France, and the portsmen in turn getting the privileges and ensuring the loyalty through those privileges.
The arrangement stayed in place for nearly 500 years, during which time the Cinque ports fleet managed to cover itself with glory, and its battle honours are as distinguished as any contemporary regiments.
They were the navy of the time. Any major conflict at sea they were a major force in. Richard I and the Crusades, the relief of Dover in 1216, the Battle of Sandwich, the Hundred Years' War, Henry VIII's campaign, and the defeat of the Spanish Armada.
So who really benefited from this deal?
I think it was one of those deals where both parties benefited. The Crown had access to ships and men who were loyal because, in fact, the benefits from their point of view were good. And the Portsmen rapidly turned the privileges, the exemption from taxation, their own courts into quite good living in terms of profit and in terms of trade.
Service to the Crown was not just restricted to the sea. Many Cinqueports have their own royal connections. The town of Rye is perhaps the best example of a Cinqueport. It has remained virtually unchanged since the late 14th century and owes much of its history to its Cinqueport status, acquired in 1156. It became styled Rye Royal in the 16th century and, typically of so many Cinqueports, is now virtually landlocked with the coast almost 2 miles away.
Rye's harbour was once one of the best along the south coast. 30 ships could be moored near the Strand Quay, with as many as 200 being able to anchor in the old estuary. Rye's commitment to the Crown as a Cinqueport was the supply of 5 ships a year. Like any Cinqueport, Rye's strategic importance made the harbour and town an obvious target for marauding pirates.
On one occasion, the French stole the church's bells and installed them in Saint-Pierre-en-Port and Valette-sur-Mer on the Normandy coast. The following year, the men of Rye enlisted the help of neighbouring Winchelsea, and they raided the town, successfully recapturing the bells.
Rye had a unique attraction for the French, for it had once been owned by them. King Canute's wife, Emma, granted Rye and other local lands to the Abbot of Fécamp early in the 11th century. Only when Henry III, in 1247, built Rye's defences, notably the Ypres Tower, was the town brought directly under the English king's control. The curious name of a local village, Rye Foran, is possibly a reminder that the Abbot of Fécamp retained a small area in the hinterland of Rye.
Of all the town's connections with the Crown, the most spectacular must have been Queen Elizabeth I's visit here in 1573.
Well, a royal progress was really to show herself to the people. The Queen had to be seen by the people. She was a sort of icon, really. She'd be on her litter, in her carriage, looking like a painting, literally, and with the makeup a lot. And she would have been staying with various courtiers en route. I know that she stopped at Northam on her way here. She must have arrived here sort of towards evening because I believe she had a meal at Northam, underneath the old oak tree outside the pub at Northam. And the pub itself cooked the meal for her, and she danced on the village green. She was a great dancer, Queen Elizabeth I. And she wasn't an absolute spring chicken in 1573, not by the standards of the 16th century, but she used to love dancing, all the latest dances. And that was where she left her shoes behind, of course, at Northam, her green silk slippers. It cost a fortune to entertain the Queen and something like 400 or 500 retainers. The town had to borrow money for her visit, as she did tend to just clean everybody out that she stayed with. They borrowed £100, but the whole clue was that for these courtiers, the very presence of the Queen was their sort of meal ticket, if you like. They were in her favour. They continued in her favour. And it was a continuous game in the 16th century to be in the favour of the sovereign. So really, it was in their best interests. Not long after that, she renamed Rye Rye Royal. And we still use that title sometimes, even today.
And where did she stay when she came here?
It's probable that she stayed in this house that we're in at the moment. This is Green Hall, opposite the church. And the mermaid round the corner, the Mermaid Inn.
Apart from naming the town Rye Royal, there was an incident which left a rather unusual reminder of Queen Elizabeth's visit here. In this lane, Trader's Passage.
One of the ladies-in-waiting was charged with the duty of looking after the Queen's valuables and jewels. Amongst the treasures was a necklace of beautiful and extremely rare black pearls. But during the stay in Rye, they somehow went missing.
Of course, the whole town was turned upside down trying to search for the pearls, but they were never found. The lady-in-waiting was racked with guilt, for she was convinced she'd lost them.
Ever since, passers-by swore that they had seen the spirit of that poor woman searching in vain for the pearls.
The story becomes even stranger, though. For after an air raid during the Second World War, the long-lost pearls were supposedly rediscovered just a few yards from here. Yet, within hours, they had utterly vanished once more. And the ghost has never been seen since. The Mermaid Inn plays another part in Rye in the Cinque's history, an altogether more sinister one.
With the introduction of customs duties by Edward I, the town became a warren of secret passages and priest holes, a hive of illicit activities. Rye fell under the control of an illegal industry, smuggling.
By imposing the duties, it created an opportunity for people to avoid them, and I think that's where the Portsmen came into their own, and that's really where piracy and smuggling became the name of the game from their point of view. The Crown, in return for its privileges, had effectively given them their own court system, their own system of government, and they could, through those, avoid any penalties.
There were several gangs. The worst gang of all was the Hawkhurst gang, led by George Grey. He was able to have 500 men at his side just for the asking, and if a customs officer came in, they'd know exactly what to do and how to deal with him. I believe one of the people they caught was actually nailed to his own front door for informing on them. One of our ghostly sightings, we have a lady in grey who's been seen on several occasions walking along the corridors. And she's supposed to be a barmaid here once who got involved with the smugglers romantically. But she was actually caught informing on them and they had her killed. And it's supposed to be her spirit that walks the corridors here today.
It was not just goods like brandy, tobacco, and tea which were smuggled. Secret passages and chambers, like this priest hole up a chimney, were perfect for smuggling Roman Catholics in and out of the country. Even the old tuck shop had a special pulley system to hide away the occasional barrel of brandy. The customs officers were regularly outnumbered and outmaneuvered.
This is where the wretched customs officers had their headquarters. They had the most dreadful time because there are far too few of them and far too many very, very cunning smugglers. There were various gangs. The Hawkhurst gang is the most famous one. They would do a smuggling job, escape the customs officers, these wretched people, and they'd later on in the evening, they'd be found round the corner at the Mermaid, just drinking and laughing at the expense of these people. The smuggled goods having been moved through pretty quick to some fence a bit further north. And of course, the attics of Rye. They were the way the smugglers could escape the customs officers, because they knew their way. All the attics of Rye interlink to this day. They could go up the back stairs, through the attics, and then nonchalantly emerge from another house on, around the corner and disappear.
Although Edward I could not have foreseen the results of his decision to impose duties, smuggling and the odd bit of piracy never detracted from the serious task of defending England's shores. But for all their successes, the Cinque's fleet were not totally infallible.
In 1377, the French, in spite of Henry III's elaborate defences, and the fact that they no longer had a claim on the town, still managed to burn Rye to the ground. However, a little further down the coast, in 1066, the most serious violation of the Cinque fleet's defences occurred. Admittedly, the fleet had been called away to the north of England by King Harold in his successful defeat of Hardrada of Norway, but it left the south coast open for William, Duke of Normandy, to land, unopposed, at Pevensey Bay. Harold was defeated at the Battle of Hastings, and all of England was conquered.
All? Well, not quite. William I came here to Dover soon after the battle and renewed Edward the Confessor's deal with the Cinque, ensuring their loyalty and privileges and securing his own beachhead and access to Normandy. Thus, the Cinque argue that William I was not their conqueror, for he never actually defeated them.
The castle at Dover bears all the hallmarks of a Norman fortress with its square keep. But in fact, William did little more than strengthen the existing Saxon hill fort. The inner walls and magnificent keep, the largest ever constructed at the time, was the work of Henry II.
Well, Henry appears to have been a bit of an oddity at the time. He travelled generally with a fairly small entourage, unlike most monarchs of the period. And indeed, he seemed to quite enjoy roughing it, staying at local inns and things like that. The stories are that when he was hunting, for example, he would frequently end the day in the woodland, dismount, roll himself up in his cloak and doss down where he was, which didn't go down too well with the entourage that he took with him.
He had a temper. He had trouble with his wives as well. He married Eleanor of Aquitaine, but he also took a mistress. And the mistress was Fair Rosamond, and he used to meet her when she was hidden in a maze, and he used to find his way there by a piece of silk. You can imagine this. I'm coming, trying to find your way through this maze, either in or out. But his wife found out, and she wasn't too pleased with this, and she was quite possessive, and made the comment of you're going to die. You know, choose, it's either poison or the knife, and I think she chose the knife, and she bled to death.
At this time, England's empire amazingly stretched from the border with Scotland in the north as far as the Pyrenees in the south. Yet Dover was a frontier port, facing as it did the French king's territory of Flanders. In Dover Castle, Henry built a highly visible deterrent.
It was not in the 13th century as the key of England. Mainly because if you take this castle when you're invading England, then you could protect your reinforcements, and then you could you would have captured England. This is the nearest point to France anyway. You know, we can see them on a good day, like today, and they can see us, and therefore they wanted to come across.
In 1216, towards the end of the reign of King John, the barons rose in rebellion and called on Prince Louis of France to claim the crown of England. Well, Louis came to England with a vast army, and within a matter of weeks, most of the southeast of England was under French control. Dover, however, under the control of a man called Hubert de Burgh, Dover Castle held out, and so did Windsor. Towards the end of 1216, Prince Louis laid siege to the castle here. And the siege lasted 6 to 8 months. The action came towards the end of that period when the French drove a mine under what was then the main gate. They collapsed the main gate, the French infantrymen got in, and the area that we're standing in now was the scene of very bloody hand-to-hand fighting. Hubert de Burgh managed to force the French back out, make good the damage on a temporary basis, and the siege continued. King John then very conveniently died, the French went home, and the castle survived to fight another day. Just behind us is an area where King John had a home built, and indeed Richard the Lionheart, Richard the First, spent 6 weeks here. Now, bearing in mind that he only spent 6 months of his 10-year reign here in England, to get 6 weeks here at Dover was quite something. Indeed, in the church, St Mary in Castro, there are graffiti marks, or crusader marks, carved into the walls by members of his entourage.
Dover is unique amongst the Cinque ports. It's the only one to still have a major functioning port. During the 16th and 17th centuries, many of the ports along the south coast began to silt up, and as the Crown needed bigger boats carrying cannon, the emphasis shifted to the larger harbours, like Portsmouth.
The last time the Cinque Ports fleet took part in a major campaign was against the Spanish Armada in 1588, but the days of ramming the opposition were over.
Firepower was the way ahead. So while the role of the ports and the fleet declined, with the consequent loss of privileges, the need for defence remained. Many of the fortifications along this part of the coast date back to the threat of invasion during the Napoleonic era. Dover, due to its strategic location and proximity to London, was the key to Britain, so its defence was vital.
Even the defences are now largely redundant. What was once the Guardian of England has now become known as a Garden of England. And all that remains of the links between the Crown and the Cinque Ports are one or two rather splendid traditions.
Every year, Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth the Queen Mother comes to stay at Walmer Castle, just 8 miles from Dover. Her role is to carry out the duties of Lord Warden, a position she has held since 1978. The full title is the Lord Warden and Admiral of the Cinque Ports and Constable of Dover Castle, a role that has been in existence for over 800 years. The Queen Mother follows in a long line of wardens that include Winston Churchill, the Duke of Wellington, Viscount Palmerston, and George V when he was Prince of Wales. But Queen Elizabeth is the first lady to hold the position. Walmer Castle was built in 1539 by Henry VIII as part of a chain of defences aimed at forestalling a possible invasion by Charles V, King of Spain and Emperor of the Holy Roman Empire.
Fortunately for Henry, the threat never materialised and Walmer was never put to the test. Now the castle has a more peaceful role as the official residence of the Lord Warden.
The original duties were to keep the sailors of the Cinque Ports in check. Because they had the privilege of setting up their own courts, it often meant some illegal acts like piracy were conveniently overlooked. The Lord Warden, in providing a direct link between the monarch and the portsmen, was often placed in a very difficult situation. The other privilege and tradition, which has continued, is the portsman's right to carry the canopy above the monarch's head during the coronation service. A position which demonstrates in ceremonial terms that the Cinque Ports are at the very heart of the kingdom and demands enormous trust on the part of the monarch.
It may seem old-fashioned, but in respecting these few traditions, my family acknowledged the Cinque Ports' long and glorious history. In coming here each year, my grandmother in particular continues the unique relationship between my ancestors and this part of the country.